I entered the profession against my will, and I said it is a parasitic profession and all that. But you know, the legend of the profession is something which is fascinating. You know, you hear of great trials, great cross-examination, great lawyers. You know, it's a dream. It's your dream to fight for liberty. It's such a fascinating, very romantic subject. But then I never thought that my boon will be granted with such plenty.
Welcome to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice and Human Rights. It is now a decade since Kannabiran passed on. He was a man, take him all in all. I shall not look upon his like again. That was Hamlet. Kannabiran was a self-taught and self-made man. In a profession where godfathers and family and class meant everything, he rose from humble beginnings to legendary heights through sheer dedication and hard work. A prolific reader, he devoured every piece of literature that came his way as he struggled through school, college, and practice. It was precisely that reading which expanded his mind. What forged him into a legend was a sensitive and brilliant defense of political dissidents and revolutionaries who were hunted down by the state during the emergency. He converted the courtroom into a literary convention, often asking his clients to recite poetry or explain the philosophy for which they were charged to the judge. He prided himself on his radical interpretation of the law, often educating the judges before whom he appeared to interpret the spirit and intent of the Constitution. He was admired and loved for his fearless defense of causes, coupled with a deep tenderness for his poorer clients, which made him a much loved figure in Andhra Pradesh. He inspired many young lawyers searching for some meaning and radical dimensions in the practice of law. As president of the Andhra Pradesh Civil Liberties Committee and the People's Union of Civil Liberties, he was critical to expanding these movements to powerful institutions of human rights defense. He was involved in human rights work across the country, which was idolized and adored, particularly in his home state, Andhra Pradesh, by the poor and disempowered and often resented by rich and powerful people, unless they had a case or a cause they needed him to fight. It is now a decade since his death, and given the state of human rights today, his presence is sorely missed. This is an effort to preserve his heritage for the bright young lawyers who are emerging today, a generation that he sincerely believed will restore decency, dignity, and justice to our country. Thank you.
The family of K.G. Kannabiran welcomes you to the K.G. Kannabiran Lectures on Law, Justice, and Human Rights. 10 years after his death, we remember his spirit, his resistance, and his constitutional insurgencies in courts and through courts and tribunals in defense of dissent, personal liberty, associational freedoms, and justice, speaking truth to power, calling for judicial accountability and state accountability, especially in the matter of repressive laws, custodial violence, and extrajudicial murders, encounter killings, calling out entrenched practices of discrimination and structural violence, and setting out the basic structures of constitutional rule. We bring together a few of the lawyers and judges who knew him personally and worked with him on cases, campaigns, and tribunals to remember their collaborations with him and reflect on future pathways of this important slice of the history of lawyering for human rights and civil liberties, rooted in the Indian experience. K.G. Kannabiran lived and worked in Andhra Pradesh, in Hyderabad. He traveled across the country, appearing in courts of trial and high courts and in people's tribunals and fact-finding missions. from Kashmir, Assam and Manipur to Tamil Nadu, Chhattisgarh to Gujarat to Punjab, Karnataka and beyond. Within Andhra, every nook and corner, every forest and town bear his footprints. Practically every court in every jurisdiction in the state bears his imprint. Every university, meeting hall, meeting ground has heard him speak untiringly on the meanings of the rule of law and the constitution. No place was out of bounds in his quest for justice. We hope to remember him through the futures of his work and through the work of those who carry it forward in so many different ways. In this specific segment of lectures, we bring together the voices of those who shared his calling. Colin Gonzalez is the founder of Human Rights Law Network. A graduate of the Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, Colin started his professional life as a civil engineer, but was drawn into the field of law through his work with unions in Bombay. He commenced formal legal study in 1979 and litigated his first case while still in law school on behalf of 5,000 workers locked out of their jobs. Upon attaining his degree in law in 1983, Gonzalez founded the Human Rights Law Network and developed it into a national organization that brought together over 200 lawyers and paralegals operating out of 28 offices spread out throughout India. He transitioned his practice from labor courts to the Bombay High Court in 1984 and was designated senior advocate before moving to the Supreme Court of India in 2001. Colin Gonzalez is a prolific writer and has written on a range of human rights law issues. He received the International Human Rights Award from the American Bar Association in 2005. In 2010, he was conferred doctorate of the university honoris causa by the University of Middlesex, UK, and received the Mother Teresa Memorial Award for Social Justice in recognition of his remarkable contribution in legal services addressing human rights in 2010. Colin Gonzalez was awarded the Right Livelihood Award in 2017.
Good evening, Kalpana, and good evening to all my friends and colleagues and comrades who are watching this video today. I was so happy when I received this invitation from Kalpana to do this video and talk a little bit about the main lesson that I learned from Khanna, how he influenced me in a very direct way in my work in law. And then of course the major part of this video will talk about some of the trends in law, human rights law, some things that I would like to share with you, some very personal, maybe personal kind of cases and stories. And the most of all, the very tough times in which we find ourselves and the things that we are needed to do. And I can almost anticipate what Khanna would have said if he were alive today. He would, of course, be in jail, given the way the lawyers are being put in jail. He would have been in jail for sedition and waging war by the use of his tongue and his brain. No gun, no weapon, no bomb, no machine gun, no knife. But his thinking and his words were as lethal as any of these weapons, so to speak. And I'm certain he would have been in jail today, were he alive. The most important lesson that I learned from Khanna was very early in my career. I moved to Delhi in the year 2000. Before that, I was in the Bombay High Court. Before that, I was in the trial court, the labor and industrial courts in Bombay. So 10 years in the trial court, 10 years in the high court, and then I came to Delhi in the year 2000. And in the Supreme Court, I was very alone. I had no one to guide me, no one to help. And I would so often come out of the court during the lunch break and call Khanna and ask him for guidance on cases. Sometimes I would have known the answer, but I wanted to hear his reassuring voice telling me that you're on the right track. Often he would correct me. But he was such a source of consolation that I could talk to him and go back to court after lunch and be totally confident in what I was saying, because I checked with Khanna. The most important thing that he taught me. And this is early in my career, because when you are a youngish lawyer, you tend to look at case law as if it's the main way to argue. Many lawyers make this mistake. I used to make it also. I was very proud of my case law book, which ran into several volumes. And my approach was case law oriented. And if I had a case, I would try to fit those cases, fit the facts of those cases into a ready-made case law, and then tell the court the facts and then show the court the judgment. And it's a fatal mistake, because case law is very different. It differs from case to case. And judges sometimes catch a young lawyer on that your facts are different, and you're trying to use a case law which doesn't correspond to the facts of your case. And he told me the first thing you have to do is not to think about case law. The first thing you have to do is, how does law and justice fit? What does your conscience tell you? What does your heart tell you? What is the argument you're trying to make? Forget the case law. And even if you have a Supreme Court judgment against you, forget the case law. What is your argument? You're a young thinking lawyer. You're a political person. You understand social change and revolution and all that. What is the revolutionary or different or radically different argument that you want to make? Think of that first. And then your emphasis is on convincing the judge that you are conceptually correct and that your arguments fit within the statute. And then you look at the case law and see, how do you get around a bad judgment? Or how do you use a judgment which is somewhat in your favor to drive home your case? But you must have your concept developed independently, articulated separately, and such that you are totally convinced about the point that you're trying to make. It took me some time to sort of shift to that terrain. I must confess, when I first heard him tell me that, I said, oh no, he's not giving me any case law. I wasted my time. My first reaction. And then when I thought about it, and as I became a little older, I realized that we are the generators of case law, not the receivers and followers of case law. We are the generators. So when we think radically, when we think differently, when we think from a pro-poor point of view, from a pro-working class point of view, from a pro-Dalit, pro-woman, pro-tribal point of view, we generate. We are the manufacturers of radical case law. And once you have that approach, then you think independently. You dive deep down in your mind to all that you've learned in politics, social movements, your interaction with workers, your interaction with Dalits and tribals. And you've learned so many things. anger about the way they are treated, when you see their suffering, and everything molds your thinking. You draw on your resources, your experiences when you travel to meet comrades in different parts of the country. And then you fashion your own case law. Your language becomes different. Your words are different. The piecing together of ideas become different. It has a true ring to it, a genuine ring to it. And you make your own case law for others to follow. I really miss Kalahari. But I suppose time comes for everyone to leave their body behind and go on to another path. But he had a truly revolutionary approach to law, which I think I have slowly picked up bit by bit, still incomplete. But had he not been around, that articulation of what I need to do to improve as a radical lawyer may not have come as well as it did. I came into the social movement during the period of the emergency. I was in IIT Bombay. I was there during the railway strike. I was not active, but I was doing some work during the railway strike. The railway workers were ordered to be thrown out of their homes by Indira Gandhi at midnight. And I remember Praful Bidwai and some friends going to the areas where the railway workers were staying, sitting on the pavement with their children and their belongings because they had been thrown out. We saw the railway strike led by George Fernandez. My mind was very troubled and molded by what happened during that period. And then there was, of course, the textile strike, a massive textile strike of 1 million workers led by Datta Sawant. Jai Prakash started his Sampurna Kranti movement. And I think in today's context, it's a wonderful phrase to use to avoid getting a charge of sedition against your complete revolution. We can take cover under Jai Prakash Narayan's slogan and try and avoid sedition charges against you by saying to people in our public meetings, what we are trying to do is social and complete revolution. I also saw the interaction between movement and the courts at a very critical period. The movements were very influential. It affected everybody. To see leaders of the opposition being put into jail, to see millions of workers across the country protest, to see the Prime Minister brought down. Amazing times for a young person to learn. And what do we learn, like during the National Movement for Independence? What do we learn from social movements? The power of the people to bring about massive change. Real change, political change, through the power of the people. The capacity of people, ordinary working class people, to sustain through terrible deprivations, torture, hunger, illiteracy, thrown out of your schools, thrown out of your hospitals, thrown out of your homes, and yet to fight. You see the spiritual, indomitable power of the people of India to resist tyranny. something that people will never see if they don't live through a period of uprising, insurrection, and revolution. You will never understand what will remain always a cliche. We say social change comes through social movements, but we rarely understand what it means. But when you see people in movement facing bullets, thrown into jail, separated from families, then you understand the enormous power and determination of the working class. And if you don't mind if I put it in a slightly spiritual way, the power of the absolute inside the individual. The power of the absolute to conquer any adversary. And that's what makes people who face injustice and are convinced that they are right and injustice must be crushed. It makes them unbeatable. Unbeatable. I saw the interrelationship between movements and the courts because I was now in the court. And I was in the High Court. I even remember the judge's name. A very nice judge, actually. Justice Pratap. Very nice judge. Fair, even-handed. And he was handling the recognition case of Datta Samant. And Datta Samant had a million workers. Plus. So there was no doubt that in all the factories, every worker was a member of Datta Samant's union. But they had a stupid law in Maharashtra where recognition was done based on your books. The trade unions used to keep these fraud books that this worker is my member, this worker is my member, this worker is my member. And workers had to sign. Workers had to sign on to that membership because they knew otherwise that Chamcha Union and the management would get them transferred or, you know, thrown out and so on. Whereas real membership and even Pautis lay with Datta Samant's union. And Justice Pratap made a terrible order rejecting the recognition application of Datta Samant's union. And I said to myself, that day, because I really believed in, to some extent, I really believed in this whole thing about the legal system and one must follow the legal system. One must not take law into your own hands. One must not do dadagiri on the streets and so on. You know what I mean? All that kind of rubbish. All young people believe that, you know. It only takes an experience to shatter this myth about the greatness of the legal system. And I thought to myself, because I was then working in the union with Dr. Samant, I was doing the legal work of the year, I said to myself, is there any, even a shadow of doubt that he has a million workers plus, and the Chamcha union really has no workers as members? How do you do this? And as I was sitting in the court, the workers gave vent to their fury, and they picked up chairs in the High Court. And they threw it at the judge. And he had to duck and bow and leave the courtroom. And it was like a picture in my mind. Workers giving vent to their fury and the judges, you know, scurrying away. And it showed something about the injustice in the legal system. It showed it so clearly that I could never after that really have faith that the legal system will ever hold in favor of the working class when it's a big issue. Yeah, a small issue, a reinstatement of a worker, transfer of a worker, here and there, yes. But when it's a fundamental issue, and this was fundamental, rights of representation, who will represent the worker? The Chamcha Union. When you've seen Datta Samant walk down the street and there are a million workers there, I couldn't reconcile with that actually. And then I saw Dr. Samant come and take power in the city, in many parts of Maharashtra. I was doing adjudication in the industrial courts. I'd spent 5 years in the court to get a 200 rupee wage increase for the workers. With all kinds of technical arguments and reference to this case law, that case law. But at the end of the day, after 5 years of litigating, 200 rupees wage increase. And Dr. Salman came along and he did strong arm tactics. I'm not saying this to support strong arm tactics at all. It should not be necessary in any democratic society. And he organized the workers at the factory gate. And I can't go to tell you about the things that he did. Some pretty wonderful stuff. Can't even describe the things that he did. But at the end of the day, when a factory said it had a 200 rupee capacity to pay wage increase, Dr. Samo could merrily get a 1,000 rupee wage increase. The workers realized. All these bullshit balance sheets and profit and loss account and, you know, all fraud. Companies are all fraud. The balance sheets are all fraud. Workers know it. Much better than lawyers. Much, much better than lawyers. Nobody could prove it until Dr. Samu came around and somebody told him, an industrial court judge told him the capacity to pay is 200, you can't get a rupee more. And then he organizes it at the gate and get 1,000 rupees more. So those were good days, very good days. And I hope they come back. In fact, I'm sure they'll come back, given the situation today. In the 80s, things began to change. So right from independence till the 80s, there was social democracy. I know, you know, trickle down and all that is not good enough. I realize that, but social democracy anyway is a kind of organizing of society within the capitalist framework. So that you try and take the working people, the poor, along with you, and a little trickle down of the wealth of the nation takes place. And people get a little bit for food, for housing, for this and that and so on. Social democracy in its more advanced form. European countries are social democratic. They get pensions. They get housing. They get occupation, health and safety, equipment. They get a sort of a salary, sort of a decent salary, some may say. And so on. Social democratic. Take everyone along and give everyone something. Those on the far left will say this is miserable, this is trickle down, this is rubbish. And those on the right will say this is socialism, this is communism, this is rubbish. And in the middle, the social democrats will do their politics. But these were also days up to the 80s where the case law developed nicely. The legal system functioned well. And I have an answer to this. I have a reason. I understand the reason for this. Was because the judges of that period had been through the national movement. They might have been rich as students or whatever, but everyone saw the national movement and understood the power of the working class. Because revolution equalizes everyone, rich or poor, you're taking part in a movement against the British. You'll go to jail just as the poor man will go to jail. So there was a sense of equity in the air. But after the 80s, it all began to go down. Those were great days for labor law. And if you look at the judgments of that period, they were great days. Reasonably good days, let me say. Let's not go overboard. Reasonably good days for labor law. After the 80s came globalization. And I can summarize globalization in three words. Subsidies are bad. Manmohan Singh was one of the most ardent followers of this policy. And along with him, the rest of the Congress and so on. And I don't suspect that the BJP was any much, much behind them. They were all in the same boat. But Manmohan Singh was the most articulate follower. And some of his ministers finance ministers and others who are today waxing eloquent about democracy were the ones who brought in with ferocious acceleration globalization in India. So much so that GDP went up to 7%. I don't know, fake GDP, genuine GDP, but it said it went up to 7%. One of the highest in the world. And we stopped saying we are a nation tiger and we started saying we are a world economic force to reckon with. I told you, social democracy, take everyone along, let some trickle down happen. Globalization says subsidies are bad. Why should we subsidize public hospitals? Why should we have public hospitals in the first place? It's not the business of government to run hospitals. Let the private sector run hospitals. Everybody will get some place when they need treatment. Schools, why should we run schools? Let the private sector run and then the poor will adjust somewhere inside that. And it went on, this argument went on, take away state support for all the activities on economic rights. Housing, live in slums. Food, remain malnourished. Right through that period where India's GDP went to 7%, malnutrition levels were also about 60%. 60% of the population lived below a poverty line of a dollar a day. Education, forget it now. We're not going to spend money. There'll be no toilets. Your teachers will not come to school and so on. Health, you need 6% per year investment. Even today, investment is 0.9%. That's why our hospitals are in the condition in which they are. Go to AIIMS in Delhi and you'll see people in the intensive care unit lying on the floor. Shameful. These champions of industry, globalization. It meant take all of this money that trickled down to the poor and give it back to industrialists. Reverse flow of investments to industrialists. Now the court was not very far behind. Now by the 90s, the old generation of judges were fading away. And a new generation of judges had come up the rungs of the judiciary. And these were not people who had any idea of the national movement, except what they read in storybooks. Might have been yuppies, might have been the sons and daughters of the rich. But globalization went into their blood. So a new generation of judges who couldn't care a hoot for equity and all that kind of rubbish. And when it came to labor, they saw labor as their enemy. Because all their family members and their friends were running factories here and there. And they were all complaining about how labor was being so irresponsible and gone on strike and so on. So, anti-labor attitudes began to prevail and grow. And I want to tell you about two judgments which were so anti-labor in their content that they killed the working class. Physically killed the working class, really. The Sale judgment converted labor into an army of slaves. Contract labor judgment. I'm doing regular work. I've been there for 20 years. I ask that I be regularized. That my contractor be removed because I'm working in your factory. And you are ultimately paying me. Abolish the contract labor. The act was so simple, it said that if the work is permanent, there should be permanent workers. That was the force of the act, intent of the act. But a constitution bench of the Supreme Court made such a convoluted judgment, which effectively said that if we declare that the contract labor system is over, the end result is that your job will also go. So abolishment of contract labor meant the abolishment of labor. What a horrible judgment. Awful. And I hope a day will come when this judgment is reversed and a simple principle be established that if contract workers are working through a contractor for 10 years, 5 years, 20 years and it's permanent work, you make them permanent. End of story. What's so difficult for a Supreme Court judge to understand that? And that to 5 Supreme Court judges not to understand such a simple proposition. And then Uma Devi, what happened in sale for the private sector happened in Uma Devi. The judgments before Uma Devi were brilliant and simple. If the man is working continuously for 5 years, why is he casual? Why is he ad hoc? Why is he temporary? 5 years he's worked, make him permanent. Courts across the country, High Court said make him permanent, make him. Supreme Court said it, make him permanent. Constitution bench comes and says nothing doing. This is backdoor entry. You made them permanent. You didn't check whether they are qualified. They are working class people, for God's sake. They've been running their lathe machines and all that for decades. They work 5-6 years, you make them permanent. When they were working as ad hoc workers, you never asked them whether they had a certificate from Harvard. Now when it comes to making them permanent, where's your Harvard certificate, Mr. Worker? And declare. It doesn't matter. You work for 10, 20, it doesn't matter. You work on slave wages, it doesn't matter. You can't be made permanent. End of story. As a result, these two Supreme Court judgments effectively created a country like India, which was run by an army of slaves. Created slavery. And then in misconduct cases, where the principles earlier were, then okay, small misconducts, don't remove from the job, for God's sake. Termination is economic death. So a worker sleeping on duty, all right, punish him. But don't remove him. A worker is absent, all right. If it's not too bad, you keep him. Punish him a bit. And if there was some gully galoch in the factory, all right. Give him a warning that next time you do. And then along came a new generation of judges. One first misconduct of sleeping on duty because the man was sick. He was not well. Termination. Missed 2-3 days. Termination. Bus conductors who were counting money made a 3 rupee difference. There was a 3 rupee difference when the raid was done between his account and the money in his bag. Corruption. Look at the corruption. Whether it's big or small makes no difference. We have to deal with it with an iron hand. Indeed. I don't want to say anything about corruption today. I better remain discreet. When large-scale corruption running into thousands of crores will get by. And this poor bus conductor, 3 rupees, he go home and tell his wife and children, I don't have work anymore to do. Take our daughters out of school. Sell our bartans and sell your jewelry. I don't know where our next meal is going to come from. So globalization and the Supreme Court. Now let me take you to TMAPI, where globalization, Supreme Court and education. Where in Unni Krishnan's case, the Supreme Court said education fundamental right. And there was a socialistic approach to education. everyone must get education, etc., etc., etc. TMAPI opened the doors for money power, capitalist money power, to get into education, because they understood, because it was clearly understood, education is big business. You can charge the children of the parents loads of money. So now the money comes in, the fees go up, exorbitant charging, all this happened. And the Supreme Court allowed it to pass. And today the rot you see in education, today, the utter rot and the takeover, commercialization, the takeover of money power, has its roots in the TMAPI judgment of the Supreme Court. So globalization judgments, my dear friend, we sometimes wonder where it all started. But if you're a practicing lawyer, you can say, you can understand, you can see that it often starts from a judgment of the court, which opens the floodgates for capitalists to get in and control that area of operation of power. This whole thing about globalization, which has been so lauded, subsidies are bad, etc., made our capitalist class have a very short-term view of what is development. We understand, you look at the German model, the European models and all that, you know. Of course, there's the capitalist system, so there's a difference between capital and labor. Physical difference also, in how you live, what you eat, all that kind of stuff. But the capitalists there understand that in order for labor to be productive, there is a level below which they should not fall. They must have nutrition, otherwise they can't work. They must have education, otherwise you can't deliver good quality products. They must live in decent places so that they don't fall sick and diseases don't spread, like in our Indian cities. And you must be trained so that you really produce top-of-the-line technological products. And you must have a helmet and protective equipment so that your health and safety is looked after. Some elementary things. But our Indian capitalists were not like that. Our Indian capitalists were a different breed apart. And they always had, and they still have, a short-term view. And they're always looking out to squeeze the last drop of sweat out of the worker. So wages fall, minimum wage is not paid. All of you know that. Nobody gets minimum wages. No unorganized worker gets minimum wages in this country. You'll have workers go up the construction sites without even a safety rope, let alone anything else. So we had a generation of capitalists growing up in that stupid way, thinking that they will make higher profits. First mistake, lower the wages, lower the expense on the worker, the better the profit. Wrong. The worse the profit in a long term. Who's to train our capitalists? Who's to make them understand what a social democracy is? And then it will be too late, because by then workers will say, we don't want the social democracy, we want full-fledged socialism. Then it will be too late for them. They'll have to take all their ill-gotten wealth and leave the country. Now I come to COVID. Turning point in Indian labor history. And when the migrant workers got onto the streets and started walking in the millions, 500, 600, 700 kilometers to go back to their villages, we saw history in the making. Because that is a fundamental rupture with democracy. And there's nothing anyone can tell the working class people about democracy anymore. If I were them, I would hate the capitalist class. I would hate these people. And I would hate these politicians, all of whom caused us such suffering and pain and hunger, ill health, illiteracy of our children. A fundamental rupture in Indian society has taken place. And the working class will not forget for many, many decades. Because it was the young that went. It was the young. Factories were closed down, the employment was stopped, the government didn't have food to give them, the hospitals closed. If you're not COVID, we won't treat you. The young working class will remember the treachery of the state, the treachery of politicians of all political parties. And in some way, they will learn the lesson of the need for revolution. People may laugh and say, oh, never going to happen. Who knows? Who knows? We never thought migrant workers in their millions would walk like this and die like this and have their wives and children die like this. In democratic India with once upon a time 7% GDP, not very long back, a year back, 7% GDP, world economic power, Asian tiger. Who thought? Who thought that the working class would experience a fundamental rupture from the entire democratic facade that we are so proud of? Who thought? And so when people say today, my dear friends, when people say today it's darkness all around us, what do we do? I'm so depressed, I hear some of my little cousins. I'm so depressed. We really don't know what to do. I would say that in periods of darkness, a breakthrough of light is imminent. Darkness of this sort will be a fundamental reset in our evaluation of what democracy is, how worthless it has become, and why it is necessary for us to mobilize, organize, educate, litigate, and fight tooth and nail against this kind of system. The Gujarat Mazdoor Sabha case, which came recently, when our brain dead politicians drafted these labor codes and so on, and said we want to increase the hours of work and we don't want to give you double for overtime. I want to just read two statements from the judgment of the Supreme Court. Brilliant judgment, really brilliant. In that sense, when you struggle, when people struggle on a large scale and people fight for their rights, judges can sometimes see you suffering. Judges can sometimes feel your pain. Not so many judges today as there used to be, but who knows? Who knows? They can feel your pain, they can see your suffering, they know the injustice. They're just waiting for a case to land up on their table. And I want to read two lines. The state cannot eliminate provisions promoting dignity and equity at the workplace. And the second, the state cannot force workers and already worn down class of society into the chains of servitude. What a brilliant judge. And it restores your faith in the legal system for a short time at least. And before I end, I want to talk about two things in criminal law, and I'll finish in exactly 5 minutes. Sedition, used everywhere. If you're a cartoonist and you draw a cartoon of our great political leaders, sedition. If your Kishore Chandra, a journalist in Manipur, who told his chief minister to FO, will be taken in sedition, spend 1 year in jail. If you're a trade unionist in Uttarakhand and you come out with a paper and you come out with a poster which said Inqilab Zindabad, sedition. And so I want to bring to your notice two cases. Just take it down because you really need to use this. One is Balwant Singh versus State of Punjab, 1995, 3 SCC 214. And the second is Bilal Ahmed Kalu, ...1997, 7 SCC 431. Very important judgments to fight against this kind of rubbish that's going on. Sedition requires an act. Colonial sedition required only words. The king needs to be overthrown. The king is a bloody fool. After Kedarnath's case, the Supreme Court decision, it needs an overt act. You said something, that's irrelevant. You said something, but you followed it up. Machine gun, bomb, killing, stabbing, wounding. So in both these cases, in the Punjab case, he came onto the streets and said, Khalistan Zindabad, Khalistan Zindabad. We should gather guns and fight for an independent country. And in the Kashmir case, he said, again, Azadi. Gather weapons and fight for Azadi. When the matter came to the Supreme Court said, this is very fine. Okay, but what did he actually do? And the answer the public prosecutors gave him was, nothing, sir. He didn't do anything. He shouted slogans, but shouting slogans itself is sedition. And the court said, nothing. Words, yes. Words followed up by actions to destabilize the state. No destabilizing. When you put up posters in Inqilab Zindabad, no destabilizing. You do a cartoon, no destabilizing. You tell the chief minister to FO, no destabilizing. And therefore, sedition is something we need to fight on a very big scale. every case destabilizing is the second case. And the next is Batali. And our friends who are in jail, like Surendra Gadling and Sudha Bharadwaj and others. Batali, remember that. 2019 5 SCC 1. 2019 5 SCC 1. The reason why they are in jail. Because it says, unlike all judgments before Batali, that if you have, if the prosecution has evidence which is not admissible during the trial, some hearsay evidence, some unsigned letter, somebody writing to somebody. If you have evidence which is not admissible during the trial, Supreme Court in Batali says you can still use it to deny bail. So any ruddy evidence you can get is not admissible. The judge will say this is not admissible. Yes, in the trial. But sir, now you're doing bail. So bail, you look at every document. So in Sudha Bharadwaj's case is a letter, not signed by her, not written by her, not found on her computer. And Justice Chandrachud delivered a stunning judgment saying that in the Bhima Koregaon case, I would not have the Maharashtra police investigate this case at all. I would give it to an independent agency. Majority said, no, give it to the Maharashtra police. So they're rotting in jail. Independent group would have said immediately, there's no case made out against these people. And so, my dear friends, on that note, I'll stop. There is so much to be done in the courts. No matter how bad things may be, always remember that there are some judges who are good human beings still in our system. And we must hope that by fighting, we inspire other judges to change their way of thinking. Because against this fascist government, otherwise there is no hope. The only thing that stands between us and jail is the judiciary. And the only thing that can save democracy is the sturdy, robust organizing of labor and people. It will happen. I don't know how soon, but I have the certainty that it will happen. And that a day will come when things will change dramatically. And I want to end with a little story that Sardar Jaswant Singh Khalra used. He had found out about the killings in the Punjab. Hundreds of Punjabi boys were killed by the police, disappeared. And K.P.S. Gill had laughed at his accusation and said, all these boys have migrated to Canada and America and Europe. And you are telling us that they are dead. They are all abroad. He went to the crematoriums of Punjab and found that dead bodies were brought there by the police. Police had told the public, the police had told the courts that we don't know where they are. But they were brought by police. And the Havaldars were so, let's say, foolish as to give their buckle number to the crematoriums in charge, right? The buckle number 50 bodies bought by Havaldar number souls. He took this evidence to Canada and he came before the Canadian Parliament and told his story, and it spread across the world. And the time came for him to go back. And he got a phone call saying, Khalra Saab, you want to know from the Punjab police how many boys were killed? You come back to India. We will give you that number plus one. He went back against advice. Before he left, he made a speech. I'd like you to see it. It's in Punjabi. It's on YouTube. And he says, and I end with this, I am in a period of darkness. There is darkness all around. I am only a little diya, and I spread my light as much as I can. But if all of us were to be like little diyas, we could be brighter than the sun. Thank you, Kalpana. Thank you, my friends. Goodbye.